Hey, good morning, everyone. Really, really lovely to see you. And just to join Elaine and welcome you to Willowfield today, my name is Clive Atkinson. I'm the rector here. Got a question for this, a musical question for you this morning. So you're going to listen to a little piece of music. I would love to say that there's a prize for the person who gets the answer right. There was a prize at the 10 o'clock service. So just saying, come to the 10 o'clock, you get prizes, okay? It was a free hot dog at 10 o'clock, but all the hot dogs are now gone, so I apologize for that. So anybody's first hand in the air, and let's hear the music, Alexa, and that would be great. Excellent. Yeah, here we go. A wee bit more. Only four so far. Five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. What comes next? Good stuff, thank you. Whose hand was up first? Sonia Clugston. Incredible. If you're ever in a pub quiz and you want somebody for the music round, that's the person that you want on your team. Well done, everybody. Who was it? R.E.M. What was the name of the song? Losing My Religion. And that's what we're talking about today. We're talking about the experience of losing your faith. I'm going to read a Bible passage for us. And it might come as a surprise to you that actually in the Bible, we have a record of people losing their religion. And this is from the Old Testament. It's Psalm 73. And I'm going to read it for you. And it's about an Old Testament believer called Asaph. And he puts into words the experience of losing his faith and how he works that through. So if you're interested, you'll see Bibles like these, like this in the seats in front of you. You're welcome to pull that out. I think it's also going to be in the screen behind me as well. There it is. And some of us like the hard copies. So if you want to do that, Psalm 73, middle of the Bible, book of Psalms, just find Psalm 73 and you're there. Here we go. Truly God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart, but as for me, my feet had almost stumbled. My steps had almost slipped. That's an Old Testament way of talking about losing his religion. Verse 3, 4, I was envious of the arrogant when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. For they have no pangs until death. Their bodies are fat and sleek. They are not troubled as others are. They are not stricken like the rest of mankind. Therefore, pride is their necklace. Violence covers them as a garment. Their eyes swell out through fatness. Their hearts overflow with follies. They scoff and speak with malice. They're lofty, threatening oppression. They set their mouths against the heavens, and their tongues strut through the earth. Therefore, his people turn back to them and find no fault in them, and they say, how can God know? Is there any knowledge in the Most High? Behold, these are the wicked, always at ease, they increase in riches. All in vain have I kept my heart clean and washed my hands in innocence. For all the day long I have been stricken and rebuked every morning. If I had said, I will speak thus, I would have betrayed a generation of your children. But when I thought how to understand this, it seemed to me a wearisome task until I went into the sanctuary of God. Then I found discernment. Truly, you set them in slippery places. You make them fall to ruin. How they are destroyed in a moment, swept away utterly by terrors, like a dream when one wakes. O Lord, when you rouse yourself, you despise them as phantoms. When my soul was embittered, when I was pricked in heart, I was brutish and ignorant. I was like a beast towards you. Nevertheless, I'm continually with you. You hold my right hand. You guide me with your counsel, and afterwards you will receive me to glory. Whom have I in heaven but you? And there's nothing on earth that I despise beside you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. For behold, those who are far from you shall perish. You put an end to everyone who is unfaithful to you. But for me, it is good to be near God. I have made the Lord God my refuge. that I may tell of all your works. Why do we pray? Father, as we open the Bible now, Lord, it is our deep conviction that it is your word written down for us. And we want to pray that you would speak to each one of us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. It was the late 90s, I think it was 1996, and I was attending an event run by Summer Madness in the King's Hall. And there was quite a famous British athlete who was the keynote speaker. And I nipped out during halftime to go to the toilet, and I walked into the gents, and I was the only one there. This might sound like a bit too much information, but forgive me. It's necessary. And I was the only one in the loo. Then I heard the door open and I looked around and there was the keynote speaker. And I have to say, this was a guy that I had wanted to meet for a long, long time. British athlete. He was the Olympic, world, European, and Commonwealth champion. Held all of those titles. And the year previously had broken the world record for the triple jump that had been held since the 1960s. Can anybody guess who it is? Anybody? Jonathan Edwards. And he walked into the loo, and I thought, I want to talk to you, but this is too embarrassing. And I didn't. But one of the things that really impressed me about Jonathan Edwards wasn't just that he was an Olympic, world, European, Commonwealth champion and a world record holder, but was the fact he was a Christian. And Jonathan Edwards would speak publicly and vocally about his Christian faith. That was 1996. 2007, there was an article in the Times newspaper about Jonathan Edwards. And it had described, in this article, it described how Jonathan Edwards was no longer a Christian, that he had lost his faith. And to my knowledge, I think that's how he would still describe himself today. Go back a little bit earlier in the 90s. This is 1992. It was Summer Madness in Gosford. Anybody attended Summer Madness in Gosford? Anybody remember those days? I am not the oldest one here. Thank you. Thank you, Hazel, digging me out of a hole there. Summer Madness was a camp in Gosford. It sort of brought together 1,500 young people for an amazing time. That year, Tony Campolo was the keynote speaker. Brilliant, brilliant speaker. Very dynamic, very passionate. So passionate, and I hope this again is not too much information. When he spoke, you could see the saliva from his mouth come out of his mouth, heading towards the people in the front row. He was so passionate when he spoke. And this characteristic about his passion and his spit became so well known that people who would attend his conferences and go and listen to him speak, if they sat in the front row, brought an umbrella with them. And so when he stood up to speak, all the umbrellas would go up in the front row as a bit of a laugh. In 2017, Tony Campolo and his son Bart Campolo wrote a book together. It was entitled Why I Stayed and Why I Left. And it's a conversation between father and son, the father who remained and remains a Christian, and the son who had come to faith and been a public Christian, but now no longer called himself a Christian. Why I stayed and why I left. We're listening to that song by R.E.M., Losing My Religion. And that's what we're thinking about today. If you haven't been to Willowfield for a while, and we're in this little series of talks entitled The Community of Friends, we've been thinking about Christian friendship, and we've been thinking about Christian friendship from a really, really practical point of view. And so we've been thinking about what does it mean to be a Christian friend with somebody struggling with addiction? What does it mean to be a Christian friend with somebody who's struggling with fear, somebody who's struggling with grief, somebody who's failed? Last week, we touched on a really, really sensitive subject. How can I be a Christian friend to somebody who's coming to the end of their life? And today, I guess, it's an equally sensitive one. We're thinking about how can I be a Christian friend to someone who's losing their faith? And we want to do three things today and probably do it hopefully within the next 15 minutes. First is, let's answer this question. Why do we lose our faith? Why do some people lose their faith? Secondly, we're going to have a wee look at the scriptures to say what the Bible says about that. And then finally, we're going to get really, really practical and see what advice the Bible gives us in terms of how we as a friend, a Christian friend, can walk with those who are struggling with their faith right now. So why do some people lose their faith? I wonder how you would answer that. Why do some people lose their faith? It's complicated. There's rarely one single reason why someone loses their faith. It's generally a whole host of reasons mixed up. It can be complicated. But there are four general areas that people have spotlighted that cause people trouble who are Christians. Here's the first one. Questions. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but I'm sure all of us at some point as we sought to follow Jesus have had questions. And maybe you've had one question or two questions that have eaten away at you and you've never ever found an answer that has satisfied you. And maybe those questions have now become doubts and those doubts are growing in momentum. And that might be you. And those questions could come for a whole host of reasons. It might be the controversy around the church. Fanta Clark, who is known to many of us here, retired bishop within the Church of Ireland. Fanta was a bishop out in the west of Ireland. On the day that the government and the Republic published its report into child abuse within the Roman Catholic Church, Fanta was walking down the main street of where he lived. He had his purple bishop's shirt on. He had his clerical collar in. He had a big cross around his chest, minding his own business. Somebody drove past, slowed down, wound down the window, and shouted out, "How dare you wear that on a day like today?" The controversy within the church can provoke such questions. Or it may be some of the really hard things that the Bible calls us to believe in, issues around heaven and hell, issues around the beginning of life like abortion and the end of life like euthanasia, or it could be issues around sexuality or transgender. Those are tough questions. And sometimes those are the issues that push people away. Questions. Here's the second one. What people would describe the dark night of the soul. Maybe you've heard of it. And it's less about questions that play with your mind, but experiences that play with your heart. An unanswered prayer that you've been praying for years. And you've prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed, and it seems that the Lord has done nothing about it. Or maybe you find yourself going through a really, really tough time, and rather than feeling God's intimate presence, actually what you experience is God's distance. You feel the hiddenness of God. That's the dark night of the soul. The third reason is what people are now calling deconstruction. You hear particularly in the United States where you hear people about deconstructing their faith, which is basically just tearing it apart. That probably is a whole sermon in itself, and maybe that's for another day. But the last one is what's referred to as issues of the heart. And it's not so much questions. It's not so much experiences. It's about what's going on deep down inside me. For those of you who today would describe yourself as followers of Jesus, you will know that God's mercy and grace is completely free. That I can be forgiven right now in this very moment and know that I am forgiven and that eternal life is mine. Not because of what I have done or what I have earned, but because it is a free gift that's given to me. You know that. But you will also know that following Jesus demands everything from you. That's what discipleship is all about. And sometimes those demands are such that we resist, that we say, "No, I'm in the driving seat, not you, Jesus." That the self-sacrifice and the self-denial that he calls us to is something that we're not willing to give him. You know, "Jesus, that's great, but you know what? I want to keep this bit of my life over here. I'm not giving that to you. I want to hang on to that. I want to hang on to that habit, that lifestyle, and you're not getting it." And those are called the issues of the heart, where I repeatedly and consistently just say, no, no, this is my life. And you take those four general reasons and you mix them together, and what you may find is that as a result of all of that, whether it's questions or experience, whether it's deconstruction or my unwillingness to say yes to Jesus fully, that can lead me into a place where I begin to further and further and further distance myself from him. I want us to have a look at the Bible, because how does the Bible respond? Imagine I'm singing along to REM, I'm losing my religion, and actually that's true of me. So what does the Bible say to someone like me that's actually walking away from Jesus, someone that's losing their religion? What would the Bible have to say? We're going to think about Psalm 3 passages, and trust me, you need your seatbelts on, because we're going to do this really, really quickly. We're going to think about Psalm 73, which we read a little bit earlier on at the beginning of our service. Here's Psalm 73, written by an Old Testament believer, losing his religion, and he's struggling with the fact that his understanding of God, God is good, doesn't match his experience of life. Doesn't match his experience of God in the world. Those two things are doing this, and he's working it out in Psalm 73. And I find that fascinating. I find it fascinating that the Bible itself, God's word, contains a whole chapter with somebody wrestling with doubt. Somebody who's struggling with their faith. I think it says something to us that here is a Bible passage that puts into very graphic and honest words somebody who's losing their religion. And I think that says something to us about the God that we worship here this morning. That God is not intimidated by your questions. God is not repulsed by your doubt. That in very fact, it's the opposite. When he hears our questions, when he understands our doubts, he moves towards us. In fact, what we have is a Bible passage that puts into words our doubts and our questions. And that says something about the God that we worship this morning. Fast forward to the New Testament. This is John 20. This is a Bible passage that we'll all know very, very well. It's a week after the resurrection. Jesus has appeared to his disciples, risen from the dead once already, but there was a guy there, guy who wasn't there. Anybody know his name? Anybody? Thomas. Thomas wasn't there. And the disciples go to Thomas, you have no idea what you missed. Jesus appeared before us. We thought he was in the tomb, but he's alive. And can you remember what Thomas says? Do you remember what he says? I can't. That's why I have to read it here. Thomas says this: unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers into his sides, I will not believe. Thomas needed to see and needed to feel before he would believe. It's quite gross, actually, isn't it? You know, have you ever gone into someone in hospital who's just had an operation and said, I don't believe you, can I put my fingers into your wound? Nobody would ever do that, but here's Thomas saying, I want to put my fingers into his side. Unless I do that, I can't believe. A week later, Jesus appears again. Thomas is there this time. How will Jesus respond to Thomas's doubt? How will he respond? Will he say, Thomas, get out of here. You've no place in my family. How dare you doubt me? Does he do that? No, he doesn't. Jesus moves towards Thomas's doubt. Jesus moves towards Thomas's questions. And he says back to Thomas the very issue thing that Thomas wanted. Here it is. Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. And just like Psalm 73 is a psalm that puts into words the person who's the doubting and the doubts and the questions that we have, here we have God himself in Jesus moving towards the person who is doubting and seeking to answer their question. I want you to know the compassion that Jesus has for people who have questions. the compassion that Jesus has who's struggling to believe, the compassion Jesus has for those who doubt. Jesus moves towards such people. But, always a but, isn't there? Do you remember what Jesus says to Thomas? See if you can finish this sentence. Put your hands here, see my hands. Put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and... There was one person over there said it. Stop doubting and believe. See, alongside the compassion comes the challenge. And you see that in the New Testament all the time. You will receive tons of compassion as someone wrestling with your faith, but you will always also be challenged. Stop doubting and believe. Jesus wants you to live by faith. He wants you to trust him. One final passage, and then we're going to move into the last lap. This passage is Mark 10, 17 to 22. Again, you will know this passage really well. I know it as the passage, the story of the rich young ruler. Anybody heard of that? Story of the rich young ruler. Comes to Jesus with an amazing question. This is a question that all of us need an answer to. He asks Jesus this question: what must I do to inherit eternal life? Brilliant question, critical question. All of us need an answer to that. And Jesus replies by listing the second half of the commandments. And the man's confident that he's obeyed all of these. And then we read this. This is uncomfortable. Jesus looked at him and loved him. I want you to know that he looks at you today and loves you. Jesus looked at him and loved him. And he said to him, Jesus said this to him, one thing you lack. And he said, go sell everything you have and give it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. And then what comes next is almost heartbreaking. At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. I want you to notice something. If you don't hear anything today, please hear this. I want you to see that in this Bible passage, not everyone ended up following Jesus. There were many people, and we see it recorded in the Gospels, who walked away. It happens. This young man walked away. And notice that Jesus didn't go after him. Jesus let him walk. And he walked away not because he didn't get an answer to his question. He didn't walk away because he felt that Jesus hadn't heard him or seen him. He walked away because what Jesus asked of him was too much. Do you see that? And people walk away not simply because of their questions, not simply because of their doubts. They can walk away because what Jesus asks of us is too much. Remember we mentioned a few minutes ago about issues of the heart? Issues of the heart are fundamental when it comes to answering the question, why do I distance myself from Jesus? And it might be because there's a sin I'm not willing to turn away from. It might be because my pride says, I'm in the driving seat, you're not. He let him walk away, and people still do today. So Psalm 73 teaches us that the Bible invites us to ask our questions, to process our questions in all of their rawness. We see in Jesus somebody who is compassionate to those of us who wrestle with our faith, but it also comes with a challenge. And in the third passage from Mark 10, we see a situation where what Jesus was calling the man to was too much for him, and he walked away. So I want to ask finally, and we're finishing, we're going into the last lap now. We're descending over the Belfast Lock and coming into land at the International, or at Belfast Harbour Airport. So 2 minutes and we're nearly finished. What does it mean for me to be a Christian friend? Because this is what we've been talking about. What does it mean for me to be a Christian friend and to walk with somebody who's losing their faith? What does that look like in practice? So very quickly, the first one is this compassion. Could everybody please say compassion with me? 1, 2, 3, compassion. A friend of mine about 8 years ago came to faith, he and his entire family. It was one of those Acts stories. It was wonderful, so encouraging for me, so encouraging from the church. Struggled with work, struggled with family, and stopped coming to church, and then announced that he was no longer a Christian. And my reaction to that, I've got to say, wasn't good. I was hurt. And that hurt also looked like anger and frustration. And what he needed from me at that time was compassion. And so please don't follow me in how to respond to your friends. Follow Jesus. Compassion. Christian friendship looks like compassion. Secondly, it looks like listening. You know what? Somebody comes to you and says, I've got these questions, I've got these doubts, I'm struggling with my faith. What do you want to do? Well, you want to give them your best answer to their questions, don't you? You want to give them 75 books that they can read. But you know what they need? They need you to listen. And listen. And listen. And if you're going to ask questions, may they be questions that draw out what they're wrestling with rather than trying to answer it. That may come later, but what they need to hear, what they need to know right now, that you're there for them to listen. Compassion, listening. Thirdly, being there for the long haul. If you are good friends with someone who's struggling with their faith, and that might be a marriage partner, it might be a child, it might be a good friend, it might be that you're going to have to walk with them for a long, long time. It might be years that you're going to be with them. And I promise you, that is going to be an awkward friendship because there will always be an elephant in the room, and the elephant's called faith. And sometimes you'll talk about it, and sometimes you won't. But we're required in that moment to be enduring, consistent, persevering friends. Compassion, listening, long-haul friendship. And there may come a moment, and I would imagine there will come a moment, when a challenge would be offered. And that challenge might take different forms. It might be finding a resource to a question, a talk on YouTube or a book to read, and that might be very helpful. A challenge might take this form, helping somebody doubt their doubts. Sometimes we've more faith in our doubts than we have in our faith, and sometimes we're actually unwilling to do the hard work of doubting our doubts. And actually a good Christian friend might help you do that. So why do you believe that? Why do you have more confidence in that position than what you used to believe? Doubting our doubts. Challenge might look like helping someone face their heart. These heart issues, which are deep and profound, but which have an incredible impact on our faith, actually helping someone face their heart. What's going on deep down? What's going on deep down? And it's often when you discover what is hidden that is the key that unlocks doubt. Helping somebody face their heart. And one of the best pieces of advice that I was given is don't burn your bridges. And my friend who chose not to be a Christian anymore, one of the things he did, he went to his house and got all his Christian books and his Bible and all his Christian paraphernalia, and he put them in a box and he went down to a secondhand bookstore and gave it all to them. He was burning his bridges. And to encourage a friend not to do that, to leave the door open, to be open to conversation, not to turn your back completely, can be really, really, really important. We run a course here in Willowfield called the Alpha Course, which is intentionally creating a space where you can come with all of your questions and all of your doubts and all of your issues and wrestle with them alongside lots of other people who've come to do that. It starts with like a 20-minute video plus a discussion time, and sometimes there's pizza and coffee and tea. In the Alpha Course, which is perfect for people struggling with their faith and perfect for people who are wanting to discover more about the Christian faith, there's stories told by Nikki Gumbel, who's the leader of Alpha, who's somebody who'd come to faith in Alpha, had lost her faith, and then 20 years later had come back to Jesus and told this story, told Nikki Gumbel this story, that there was never, ever, ever a day in those 20 years when he was walking away from God. There was never, ever, ever a day when he knew that God was not there. God was there every day, and he knew it. So can I encourage you today, to those of you who are walking with loved ones who have lost their faith, do not give up. Keep praying. Keep being that friend. And if you're here today and you think of yourself as someone who is losing their faith, please don't do it on your own. Ask questions. Find someone that you can talk that through with. Elaine and I and the members of the staff team here would love to spend time with you, and you will find compassion and space with any member of the team here. And maybe Alpha would be perfect for you. Alpha's going to kick off here on the 20th of September. We'd love you to come along to that. You can sign up for it. And you can come with your hardest question, your angriest question, and I know that you will be met with patience and hopefully an answer as well. Elaine's going to come and lead us in prayer. Let's pray.